ಸಹನೌ ಭುನಕ್ತು ಸಹ ವೀರ್ಯಂ ಕರವಾವಹೈ ತೇಜಸ್ವಿನಾವಧೀತಮಸ್ತು ಮಾ ವಿದ್ವಿಷಾವಹೈ ಓಂ ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿಃ. ಗುರುರ್ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಾ ಗುರುರ್ವಿಷ್ಣುಃ ಗುರುರ್ದೇವೋ ಮಹೇಶ್ವರಃ ಗುರುರೇವ ಪರಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ಸಚ್ಚಿದಾನಂದರೂಪಾಯ ವಿಶ್ವೋತ್ಪತ್ಯಾದಿಹೇತವೇ ತಾಪತ್ರಯ ವಿನಾಶಾಯ ಶ್ರೀಕೃಷ್ಣಾಯ ವಯಂ ನಮಃ. ನಿಗಮಕಲ್ಪತರೋರ್ಗಲಿತಂ ಫಲಂ ಶುಕಮುಖಾದಮೃತದ್ರವಸಂಯುತಂ ಪಿಬತ ಭಾಗವತಂ ರಸಮಾಲಯಂ ಮುಹುರಹೋರಸಿಕಾ ಭುವಿ ಭಾವುಕಾಃ. ಜನ್ಮಾದ್ಯಸ್ಯ ಯತೋನ್ವಯಾದಿತರತಃ ಚಾರ್ಥೇಷ್ವಭಿಜ್ಞಸ್ವರಾಟ್ ತೇನೇ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಹೃದಾಯ ಆದಿಕವಯೇ ಮುಹ್ಯಂತಿ ಯತ್ಸೂರಯಃ. ತೇಜೋವಾರಿಮೃದಾಂ ಯಥಾ ವಿನಿಮಯೋ ಯತ್ರ ತ್ರಿಸರ್ಗೋ ಮೃಷಾ ಧಾಂನಾ ಸ್ವೇನ ಸದಾ ನಿರಸ್ತಕುಹಕಂ ಸತ್ಯಂ ಪರಂ ಧೀಮಹಿ. ಧರ್ಮಃ ಪ್ರೋಜ್ಜಿತಕೈತವೋತ್ರ ಪರಮೋ ನಿರ್ಮತ್ಸರಾಣಾಂ ಸತಾಂ ವೇದ್ಯಂ ವಾಸ್ತವಮಸ್ತು ಶಿವದಂ ತಾಪತ್ರಯೋನ್ಮೂಲನಂ. ಶ್ರೀಮದ್ಭಾಗವತೇ ಮಹಾಮುನಿಕೃತೇ ಕಿಂ ವಾ ಪರೈರೀಶ್ವರಃ ಸದ್ಯೋ ಹೃದ್ಯವರುಧ್ಯತೇತ್ರ ಕೃತಿಭಿಃ ಶುಶ್ರೂಷುಭಿಸ್ತಕ್ಷಣಾತ್ ಶುಶ್ರೂಷುಭಿಸ್ತಕ್ಷಣಾತ್. ವಿ ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ 20th ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್. So in the last couple of chapters, with specific questions of Uddhava being asked, the Lord starts giving specific answers. So we have seen with regards to the question of Varna and Ashrama Dharma. Then the Varna Ashrama Dharma is laid out for the ultimate Moksha Dharma. For that moksha dharma, what is required? That these ashrama dharmas are followed with bhakti, jnana, niyama, yama and various other qualities which we have seen yesterday. Uddhava ji has some other questions now. So Uddhava says, Uddhava vacha vidhischa pratishedhascha ನಿಗಮೋ ಈಶ್ವರಸ್ಯ ತೇ ಅವೇಕ್ಷತೆ ರವಿಂದಾಕ್ಷ ಗುಣಂ ದೋಷಂ ಚ ಕರ್ಮಣಾಂ. ಭಗವಾನ್, ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ನೋ ಡೌಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಕಮ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಯು ಇನ್ ದ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಫ್ ವೇದಸ್, ಬಟ್ ದೀಸ್ ವೇದಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸೋ ಟ್ರಿಕಿ. ವೈ ಆರ್ ದೇ ಸೋ ಟ್ರಿಕಿ? ಇಸ್ ವಿಧಿಶ್ಚ ಪ್ರತಿಷೇಧಶ್ಚ. There are lots of do's and don'ts. When you try focusing, trying to understand what these do's and don'ts are, it is quite natural that we forget what the purpose is. If you ever have attempted in learning Sanskritam, it's pretty easy actually language, because rules are very less. The exceptions are in volumes. The rules are simple to understand, but the exceptions are in volumes. So, by the time you understand entire volume of exceptions, there is a high chances that you forget what the rule is. So, here he says, Bhagavan, you are definitely the very source of the entire Vedas, but because of these do's and don'ts, we forget as to what we have to learn from this. And he says, if we do not look at this world from the guna and dosha drishti, then we will not be able to give up that which has dosha in it and follow that which has guna in it. But then intermediately, this entire process has been given in such strict measures, and it has been given in various levels of results, it becomes little confusing. So he says, Bhagavan, my question is simple based on all this what I have been narrating to you. What is the question? He says, in this world, when there is so much of guna and dosha, what are the things that I have to really follow? What are the things that I have to not follow? How do I know what is to be followed, when to be followed, what is not to be followed and when not to be followed? It seems very difficult to understand this. So, Bhagavan says, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha. I think it is the same kind of approach that you find Bhagavan give even in the Bhagavad Gita. Whenever a question is asked, he first tries to narrate the entire background so that the questioner understands from where it has been, from where it can be easily understood. So, Bhagavan says nothing related to the question. First he sets up the entire stage. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Yogastrayo Maya Prokta Nunam Shreyo Vidhitsyata Jnanam Karma Cha Bhaktischa Nopayonyosti Kutrachit. There are three paths that I have given in the perspective, in the view that it should bring the best purified minds in this world. What are the three paths? Jnana, karma and bhakti. Path of knowledge, path of action and path of devotion. This is meant for the parama kalyana of the entire humanity. But then, who is the one who is qualified for jnana? Nirvinnanam jnayogaha Nyasinam iha karmasu. Jnana yoga, who is qualified? The one who has, with respect to the karma and its karma phala, has no intention for any karma or karma phala to be owned by themselves, to be claimed by themselves. They will perform their duties, they will perform their responsibilities, but they will not do it aiming for, say, power, name, fame, nothing of that kind. So, Swamiji, if there are such kind of people, then they are almost realized. So, Bhagavan says, no, they are not realized, but they are the actual ones who are qualified for Jnana Marga. Most of us, when we hear the Jnana Marga, why do we seem to get confused? We seem to get confused because our convictions are in the level of reality wherein we believe that what I do, what I interact with the world outside is where my sukha is, my ananda is. But the scriptures say that that is not even the starting point of spirituality in the Jnana Marga. Because karma is performed as only a duty and a responsibility, not for the results of it. And this is what Bhagwan probably has spent maximum time in trying to explain in the entire Bhagavad Gita, starting from a simple shloka. Karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phalahe turbhuhu ma te sangostva karmani. Perform your actions, because the actions begin because of the layers and layers of tendencies that are there inside. To wash them, this expression of duties and responsibilities is the best method to purge them. And the attitude with which we work is, we anticipate a certain result out of karma. So Bhagavan says that ma phaleshu kadachana. The phala, karma phala, should not be the inspiring force to start a karma. Why? Net result of all karma that we perform is only for one thing, that we aim for happiness, contentment. These are the various shades of it. And we do not find it. So what happens at the end when we do not find what we have been searching for? There is a deep sense of disappointment. So please do not start the karma for the purpose of attaining happiness. It will not take you there. When will we understand that? Scriptures bhale hi bol le, when they will keep talking about it again and again and again in various perspectives. But when will our intellect get convinced of this statement? When from 360 degrees, why just 360? From all 10 directions. 10 directions? Yes. North, east, west, south. North, east, southeast, southwest, and north, northwest. So you have 8 directions, and up and down, adaha and upari. So when you have 10 directions and you are inflicted with so much of pressure as a result of our own karma, we keep planning and planning and planning, and from all directions only hopelessness appears. Then over a period of time, better it not be in the very end phase of life, that the intellect, the ego associated with it gets really pulped down. There is no better teacher. You must have been seeing with your own children, right? You keep telling them to do certain things in certain way. Do they listen to you? Yeah, once in a month when you get that Rudra avatara, Bhadrakali avatara, yeah, there is some seeming difference, seeming change. But then, yathasthanam pratishthapayami, it goes back to the same old habits. It doesn't change. When does it change? When that individual is put in the same kind of environment wherein they have to really suck it up and be that responsible, until that challenging moment comes, these words will not have even a dent in our personality. Karma has to have that effect on us. Then we are qualified for jnana. Wherein there is no craving that I have to be performing this so that I can be happy. That idea, that attitude is taken away. But then Swamiji, until then what do we do? Then you are qualified for karma yoga. Because there is lot of ambition, lot of things that you think, you feel, we can do a lot of things outside. Some on a selfish motive, some on a selfless motive. But there is immense energy that has to be expended. Like I asked some of these parents, why do you force your children into so many various things in this country? You know, they have to be in dance, one east, one west. They have to be in music, that too vocal, one east, one west. One instrumental, one east, one west. Then game, at least one or two games. Then spelling B, math B, geography B, the way A B, O B, sub B. As if this is not enough, then Kumon math, this math, that math. Then Sunday, Sunday Chinmay Mission also. So I was told a unanimous answer, which was very common. What was the answer? The answer that most of the parents gave was, it is because the children have so much of energy that they have to be shown avenues wherein they can use that energy, and while using that energy gain certain talents also. Nice way to look at it. Similarly, as a jiva, we have immense potentiality within. There is a lot of ambition within. And it feels unjustified that how can I just be sitting doing nothing wherein I can achieve so much. And there are such people who get, I should say, mad, angry with people like us. Once I was coming, this is almost 17, 20, 18 years ago issue. I had gone to a nearby place near Vijayawada, which was 4 or 5 hours journey, I think. The roads were not that great, so I had to take a bus. So I had gone, delivered the lectures, everything was done. And after the discourses were done, I came back. As I was sitting, at a window, and there was another person who sat next to me in the next seat. So he looked at me, smiled, and he said, "I am a lawyer." Good, glad to know. And I don't know if it is just a Telugu mindset, but whenever we are too emotional or want to show off, we try to speak only in English. It could happen in other languages too, but he was like in between, using a couple of sentences in English and one or two words here and there in Telugu. But he was trying to look at me for some kind of a reaction. You know, wearing this clothes, you don't know whether that fellow knows some English or not. So he was a little skeptical. So I put him at ease when I started responding to him in English. He was glad. So he turned and asked, "What do you do?" After he introduced himself. So I said, "Nothing as a profession or anything. I have taken to this path of sannyas." Man, he got so angry, so agitated, almost started yelling at me. And the entire bus was looking as though I have just picked his pocket or slapped him or did something really illegal against him. He started screaming. And as I said, when they get too emotional, they start rattling in English. "You are such a wasteful burden on this society and earth. You at this young age, when you could have done so much for this society, you have taken this path, and how foolish of you." For next 4.5 hours, I had a nice entertainment. In Indian buses you don't have the radio system or anything. I had a live radio. And he tried logicking it out. I mean, from his perspective, it's true. There's a lot of ambitions. There are a lot of things that, you know, that can be achieved, that can be done, that should be done, is the belief. For such people, karma marga is prescribed. to change that karma marga into karma yoga, it takes subtlety of intellect, purity of intellect. What is the subtlety and purity of the intellect here in changing karma into karma yoga? Performing the duties, performing the responsibilities, performing the obligations, bringing out our best in trying to reach out to the society and do a lot for that society. It can be done in various perspectives. It can be done because I have that desire to do, I have the strength to do, and I don't mind the recognition that comes along with it. What is wrong? I have really strived hard. If somebody recognizes and pats my back, I feel good. There is nothing wrong about it. That is one perspective. Then there is the other perspective wherein it is a part of your duty, because it is something that you have been conditioned to say that it is the right thing to do and hence I am doing it. All these perspectives put aside, when does karma become karma yoga? Only two steps to understand. But to grasp the meaning of these two steps is where we need purity and sharpness of intellect. Tikshna buddhi and sukshma buddhi, both are required. So what is the two step formula? The formula is Ishwararpitam nechaya kritam. That duty that you are performing, that responsibility that you are doing, that various ambitions that you are trying to achieve, you very well achieve them. But dedicate them to a higher altar. How high can the altar be? Like you give answers to me, I also give. It depends. It depends on what? Various factors. What are the various factors? It depends how high you are. See, if I think of myself as very small, then my altar also cannot be that big. It has to be reachable, right? If my ego is really big, and that big ego also can be doing some petty little things. So the altar can be at various levels. What are the various levels of altars? Even when the job done, responsibility is fulfilled, is something little bigger than my selfish existence. To start with, dedicating my actions for my family, my husband, my wife, my children. There was one fellow who standing in front of me in a temple, and as his turn comes to do the namaskar for the Lord, as he is prostrating, he says loud, he calls out loud, he says, Keval mujhe aur mere bachchon ki hi raksha karna. I didn't have any objection when a prayer is said that, you know, protect me and my children. Keval is where I had the objection. Keval means that you protect only me and my children. Baki sab bhad mein jaye, how does it matter? See, when we dedicate our actions to the family, it is better than dedicating with the egoistic idea that it is only selfish. So you expand a little to the entire family. Anybody other than this family, I may not be able to expand. I am very rigid. My expandability stops there. And that is the reason that though being a mother, that mother becomes pretty violent when there is a new person comes in as a daughter-in-law. You know, that has to expand. that expanding nature doesn't happen that easily. It might happen, but it happens rarely. Let me put it that way. That expanding nature has to be there. So, dedicating it beyond this ego to the family. And to tell you a fact, almost 80-90% of people, they constantly work in dedicating every effort of theirs for their own family. So that my children should be happy, so that my next generation that is born will should get the best. I don't mind taking that trouble. Little subtle, they have grown a little higher altar, family. Expand that, the neighborhood or the society. Take one or two causes that really bother you and work in volunteering, helping, resourcing, providing for those causes that really appeal to you. Grown a little, the altar has become a little bigger and subtler. There are some people who dedicate their entire life for fields of science, arts, culture. So even that is a dedication, that they have spent all their efforts, time, resources, energy, money for that cause. Little bigger and subtler is for the nation. You know, when there are certain people who have spent their lifetime in trying to rebuild the nation, and their entire time, entire resources were dedicated only for that. And that is why in our, even in our Hindi, we recognize it as Desha Bhakti. Even that act of dedication, because of this, the subtlety of the altar, it is called bhakti. When you dedicate it to your family, pitru bhakti, matru bhakti, we keep hearing that too. The highest altar that you can dedicate is to the altar of Supreme, none less. To that Supreme alone. Ishvara arpitam. And then nechaya kritam. When we do perform the actions, let that be growing from the selfish attitude to the selfless attitude. First we go help, we go serve, because I have, they don't. I feel obliged to go help. Fine, that is the starting point. I have, there are the have-nots, so I have to reach out. Then comes the layer wherein the next step of growth is you really feel for them, you become one with them who are really in need of that service. You become so one with them that it is not them who are having problem, but you become one with them. That entire problem, you take it on your own shoulders and try finding solution for them. The next level, the highest level, is when we can serve, when we can worship them, when we can worship those whom we are serving from the aspect, from the perspective that it is the Supreme. In that form, helping and serving them is serving the Lord. That is what Gurudev meant in his pledge, which we every Sunday meticulously chant. Service to the nation is a service to the Lord of Lords. And serving the humanity from that perspective, that it is the Lord in that form, and to that Lord in that form is my service being dedicated to, is the subtlest level. So, Ishvara arpitam nechhaya kritam. then it becomes karma, karma yoga. Now what about the people? I don't have any kind of ambition or anything per se in motivating me. I do it because it has to be done. I do things because it has to be done. If things come by, yes, I do enjoy them, that is fine. I am not verily attached, but I have my own weaknesses. Now, for such people with their punya phala, Bhagavan says, jata shraddhastu yah puman, that with their shraddha, that there is some moment wherein they found the Lord of their heart. And with that Lord of the heart, when they started hearing the stories of the Lord and various puja, kirtana, even parayana, when they start performing. And that is the reason we find the most in this category. If you say that there is, say, Hanuman Chalisa parayana, 108 times. And we started the other day, we had Hanuman Chalisa Parayan. I ended up seeing people whom I never end up seeing. I know that their children are here, they come, but I have never seen them otherwise. I see them there. Akhanda Ramayan Parayan will come. So that is also a good punya phala. They're drawn to the chanting, they are drawn to that constant, they don't mind going through that, you know, hardships of continuous doing things, but doing it in the name of the Lord. Anywhere there is a bhajan, sankirtan, such chanting, they'll definitely find time for it, which is good. They are qualified for the bhakti yoga. Now, all these various karmas with the vidhi and nishedha, vidhi, vihita karma, that which you ought to be doing, nishedha, nishiddha karma, that which you should not be performing, they have been given for one purpose only. What is that one purpose? That our mind becomes purified, dispassionately we grow out of the world of happenings. That is why this vidhi and nishedha are given. Once we get that vairagya, then that vidhi and nishedha is not meant for them. Until then, they require. Like for example, till what time do we need crutches? Until you can confidently start walking. Even while the children are going, they get those three wheels thing, right? They hold on to it and run around. How long do they need? Until they can confidently stand on their own feet and not, you know, wobble and walk straight, until then. Vidhi and nishedha are meant till then. But what is the point that one has to understand? That there is vairagya within, there is that purity within born. Now with that purity, when that heart is dedicated to the Lord and his stories, such prepared chitta, such prepared mind, very easily transcends all the hardships in sadhana and gets absorbed in Paramatma. Not having that preparation, we directly come onto the seat of meditation. What does it lead to? And this is not a new statement. Bhagavan has said it in Bhagavad Gita, then there is in the Yoga Vasishta. Vasishta Mahamuni says this to Ramji also. If the unqualified sit on the seat of meditation, what happens? Kleshaha adhikataraha tesham. Instead of getting any sukha, what they get is klesha. And what do they attribute that klesha to, that pain to? I tried meditation, you know. It didn't work. Why? It used to give me a lot of body pains and my mind felt too distracted while I was trying to sit for meditation. I think I was better off without meditation. Before you use a vessel for cooking, what is the basic thing that you do? Even though it is washed and kept inside, before you use, what do? You rinse it at least once and then use it. Just to be sure. Similarly, don't we think it is a preparation required for the mind to be cleaned? At least a natak to be done, that mind has to be cleaned. Some effort. Unprepared, we come and say, okay, teach meditation. And where is the mind? The mind is not there. But when the mind is prepared through karma yoga, through jnana yoga, through bhakti yoga, when it is prepared through all these stages, and with that prepared mind, when we sit, it becomes easy. How do we decide whether it is a prepared mind or not? That when not required, I can stop the continuous trains of thoughts and yet be awake. Our trains of thoughts, when do they stop? When we sleep. This is a condition. What is the condition? That I have the accessibility over my mind, wherein if I choose a certain theme, certain train of thought for its fulfillment, I fulfill it. And after having done with it, I withdraw from thinking, I withdraw from processing. Is it a possibility? Without feeling mechanical, without feeling bored, without feeling burnt, ability to withdraw the mind from the world of happenings at will. The intellect having the subtlety and having the sharpness to not fall prey to any happening that we get involved in, not get conditioned by anything. Such unconditioned intellect and this prepared mind, when they sit on the seat of meditation, then we enter the third phase. What are the two phases that we know? We think and sleep. These are the only two phases that we know right now. The third phase is, though I am not processing anything, I am awake, I am alert, I am vigilant, absorbed into the silence of my own being. In such nishtha, what happens is called jivan mukti or atma sakshatkar. Asmin loke vartamanah swadharma sthano anagha shuchihi jnanam vishuddham apnoti mad bhaktim va yadrachaya. So such people with the pavitra and sinless anagha mind sit on the seat of meditation, vishuddham apnoti, they get absorbed in their own presence, in their own being. Now such people neither desire for swarga nor desire for naraka. Wherever they are quite comfortable there. And this is, they don't even desire to have a human form or a human body in its continuation. Until we read the scriptures, we are not even cautious of what we do, where we do, on when we do it. As it constantly keeps saying that what we have as a human birth is a rare chance. So we look at our own lives, our own mind, our own intellect, and pray. I may not be able to get this moksha or mukti within this life. Maybe at least if I can assure myself by doing good deeds that I continue in a human life. So that kramena, you know, in a step by step process I can aim for that. But if the intensity is strong enough, then that kind of prepared mind, Bhagavan says, they don't have abhimana, they don't have any clingings in the conditionings in their mind, because they understand. Though we aim for sukha in this life, what we have seen continuously, various shades of only dukkha, dukkhameva anubhavitam. That is what we have been facing. And all these various processes of purification, what do? They achieve only one purpose. Dukkha nivritti. When do we get sukha? When that mind and intellect is absorbed, the individuality is completely evaporated, what happens is called bliss. Until then, disappointingly, what we go through various stages is shades of dukkha, percentages of dukkha. Earlier it was 100% pure dukkha. Now it is not that pure. Even though there are moments of dukkha, I can go through it very easily. I am not, you know, like I have hit the rock bottom. See, sometimes when you don't use certain things in your vocabulary, for you don't use at all and you only hear from somebody, it is very difficult to remember those words. So I'm done. I think I have hit the lowest in my life, rock bottom. The world where there is no dukkha, searching for sukha, the world where there is no sukha, searching for sukha, what will be the result? It does not have it in its nature to give us happiness. Try what we may. The entire volumes and volumes of scriptures have been trying to show that point from various stories, analogies, various kinds of, you know, anecdotes, logics. Maybe one of these will hit. So here Bhagavan takes an example. He says, how is this manushya sharira? This manushya sharira, it is something like a tree. And what happens to this tree? There is a nice nest, the jiva is living there. But right since the day that this tree was born, the messengers from Yama are constantly cutting that tree. As day passes by, they are reaching to the core of the trunk. And what do we do as every year passes by when we mark that day? We celebrate it. What great have we done to celebrate? And we have reached to some of the ridiculous traditions wherein we are trained to eagerly await for our birthday. Why? That day we can have lots of fun, lots of gifts, lots of friends, lots of party. I would say that, not being a pessimist, understanding it from a different perspective, it is a yearly one, at least an indicator for us, the day for mourning. Krishna Paramahamsa, when he used to stand in front of Mother Kali, yearning sincerely for her darshan, he would cry at her feet. He would cry at her feet saying, Mother, another day wasted without having your darshan. In a yearly celebration, another year wasted. And most of our efforts are like treadmill efforts. What are treadmill efforts? You put lot of efforts but reach nowhere. He is there. Such efforts are called treadmill efforts. You don't reach nowhere. You are stuck there. Or what is that other little rat kind of a thing that... Hamster. Hamster effort. Poor thing keeps running, keeps running, keeps running. Where does it go? Nowhere. If at least we understand, I have to reach nowhere. Like some of the trucks here have good messages on them. You ain't lost if you don't have a destination. You are not lost if you don't have a destination. You are just exploring around. But if you have an aim, if you have a destination to reach, and you are going only in circles like the hamster, sad. Sadness is only the result. So, in the typical way, the birthday when it comes, you know, you take a shower, at least on that day. And wake up early, take shower, go to the temple. Why? You have to take the blessings. Lord, another year passed by. Give me sadbuddhi. And that is a day to mark to do some punya karma. You go out and do some annadana, vastradana, godana. But now the culture has so improved that we say to dana, go. There is no dana anymore. There is no punya karma, there is only more. And we train our next generation too. Your birthday is fast approaching. What do you want, dear? One child or maybe two children per family, the entire focus attention only on them, as if we are their beck and call, trying to provide for everything that they ask. And birthday is the time for it. Especially belonging to an affluent community that we are, the purpose has to be understood. This is, as days pass by, the Yamadutas are constantly cutting, chopping the tree. Like any bird, they say the animals have this tendency to understand or sense danger coming in. And I have been told, not seen it, but I have been told that in various parts where there was this tsunami hitting in, hours before, 7-8 hours before the tsunami could hit, all the animals in the wild, they chose to run to some higher grounds, all of them. If you in your backyard, if you observed the squirrel, when it is normally doing its own things, it makes certain sound. When it sees something which is dangerous, the sound that it makes is entirely different. I was with an old Swamiji in Uttar Kashi, and walking with him, suddenly he stopped me. Don't you hear the squirrels? Yes, I do, but I don't know how to interpret them, I said. So either it is a deadly animal or a snake or something that is that they are so cautious about. And as it was true, there was a snake, a good sized one. Okay, whenever there is a danger, these animals have that sense to sense it. So what does the pakshi do, the bird do when it is sitting on the nest of the tree which is being almost cut? Before the tree falls, the bird flies away. Similarly, the jeeva sitting on this vriksha, what does he do? It flies away. But with the association of various things that it carries along, he has to come back and again sit on a different tree. But the best deal would be to understand that before the tree is cut, I completely disassociate from that tree. And as the tree falls, I see it fall. I don't need to fly away to take rest on another tree, but to merge back into that infinite nature. Into that infinite nature as I am sitting in the tree. So here he says, "Hey Uddhav, the question that you have asked is with regards to the vidhi and nishedha, the various ashrama, varna, dharma that have been dictated through the dharma shastra, through the Veda shastra that has been given. Understand, the purpose of it is to purify oneself from the existing layer of ignorance. And to enable that phase faster is this jnana, bhakti and karma. Wherever we are, apply these three parameters into our life to execute our varna and ashrama dharma. We purify ourselves fastest. That is the reason that this marga, this path has been identified and given. Now, because Uddhav's basic question was about the guna and the dosha, that is okay, I'll tell you about that also. As to how do we understand the guna and the dosha? So that comes in the 21st chapter. He says,
Yayetan matpato hitva jnana bhakti jnana kriyatmakan kshudran kamanschalai pranaihi jushantas samsarantite. Sve sve adhikare ya nishtha saguna parikirtitaha viparyayastu doshasyat ubhayo resha nischayaha.
So what is guna and what is dosha? So Bhagavan says, sve sve adhikare ya nishtha sa gunaha. In performing our own swadharma, understanding our dharma as varna, as ashrama, as the vyavahara dharma at that levels and performing them is called its guna. Viparyayahatu, contrary to that, is called dosha. So what is the, just to take a live example, if I have chosen to sit quiet, some corner, I have chosen to sit quiet, and somebody comes and asks, why are you sitting quiet? Just like that. If I have announced that there will be talks on Bhagavatam and then come and sit here and then try to sit quiet. This is viparyaya, contrary to the vyavahara dharma. What does the vyavahara dharma decide? Vyavahara dharma decides that I speak. What does the ashrama dharma decide? The topic that I speak on. Sometimes these university kids, they come and ask funny questions. I shouldn't say funny, but so they said, Swamiji, we want to invite you to talk to us Hindu students in the university. I said, gladly. So I gave them a beautiful topic. I think it was mind management and beyond, something like that. So they came back saying, the topic I asked my various other friends, they said it is too boring. I said, okay. You choose, you select. So that kid calls me back after a day and he says, Hindu perspective on dating, premarital relation. See, if that be the end question, you can give pointers say, for a minute or two and leave it at that. So the vyavahara dharma decides that I have to speak. Ashrama dharma decides the topic that I have to speak. And taking that ashrama, taking that responsibility and living, understanding those parameters is guna. The same speaking and the speaking on the same topic can also become dosha. When uncalled for, in just because there is a gathering, there is some people sitting, I start speaking. Just because I have the habit of speaking now. My speaking becomes dosha. You understand? Guna, dosha. Sve, sve, adhikare, ya nishtha. Understanding what is the adhikara at every single moment of life. And performing according to that, that performance is called its guna. And it contrary to that is called dosha. So there is at various levels, at vastu level, at the dravya level, at the intention level, guna, dosha, shubha, ashubha, shuddhi, ashuddhi, various levels to be understood. So he says, what are the various things to be understood? When we perform various karma, now, whether we understand these duties, these regulations or not. Because at every single moment to be so conscious and to be doing things, inadvertently we may be committing something which is dosha or something which is supposed to be guna turning into dosha, we may never know. So Bhagavan says, I give you a big blanket to cover all of you. What do you call it? All compromising insurance, Bhagavan gives. What does he say? Mantrasya cha parijnanam karma shuddhi madarpanam dharma sampadyate shadbhihi dharmastu viparyayaha. Whenever you perform anything, snana, dana, tapa, avastha, samskara karma vihi. Whenever we perform whatever karma that we perform, whether it is uchita or anuchita, whether it is guna or dosha, you have tried to be as sincere as possible, but you may never know. So with all these karma, what do you do? Bhagavan says, offer it by taking my mantra. Taking the name of the Lord. Every karma that you perform, before and after you perform, What do you do?
Just as simple. Take the mantra of the name or the name of the Lord.
Like we start this discourse. We start with Om. We end the discourse with Om. All the guna dosha are covered. Blanket check. It's all covered, insured. So daily in the morning when you wake up, after you freshen up, stand in front of that Lord or sit in front of that Lord and take 5 minutes. Oh Lord, thank you for this day. Why?
Nishvase natu mama vishvasaha.
The air that goes in comes out. What is the guarantee that it will come back in again? Nishvasa natu mama vishvasaha. But still, I made it through the night and I woke up. Thank you for a good bright day. Bless me that I have sincerity. Bless me that I understand where I have to use my strength. Bless me to have that intelligence. Let me go through the day. After the entire day is done, O Lord, thank you for a beautiful day. Start with the beginning of the day and end of the day at least. Then slowly develop wherein all the important karma, all the important deeds that you are supposed to be performing. Think of the Lord and end it with the thought of the Lord. With every single action that you perform. Like yesterday or day before yesterday I was saying, you know, when you sneeze in this country, what do you have to say? Now others say bless you, but what do you have to say when you say when you sneeze? We usually say, excuse me. Were we born with that habit? It has become a second nature, right? The moment we sneeze, even if that sneeze is as silent, I don't know how some people manage it though. And that is a sneeze. Thank you. He says, if nobody is around, we still say, excuse me. Me, please excuse me. If nobody is around. If that has become such a habit, what is wrong in developing? Don't tell me that it is a difficult habit, difficult thing to form that habit. Okay, even if you have to say for others' convenience to say, excuse me, take the name of the Lord. Krishna, excuse me. Before you do something, after you do something, mentally think of that Lord. I mean, I don't have one particular Lord in my head. Whichever Lord comes into your head at that moment. Krishna, Shiva, Rama, Govinda, Amma, whatever name comes into your mind, take that name, chant that name. Snanadhanatapo asthavirya samskara karma bihi matsmritya chatmana shaucham. Just by uttering my name, that act will be purified. Words of the Lord. Even if you say those things as a mechanical thing, I may not be able to prove this logically to you as to how beneficial it is. Just give it a benefit of doubt. Do whatever karma, develop the samskara of taking the name of the Lord. Mat smritya chatmanah shaucham. That act becomes purified. So here he
he goes into the depth of analysis. I'll take a couple of examples. Dravyasya shuddhi cha ashuddhi, dravyena vachanena cha. There are certain things wherein dravya, vachana, samskara, kala and mahatva or alpatva, it is decided by the various samskara. When there is too much of water in food, you have to drain it. You know, when you used to cook the food in the pot, you have to drain the excess water. But the same water, when you bring that food and offer it to the Lord, is used to sprinkle on all that food to purify it. So water can be used as a purifier, and excess of it can also be called an impurity. So the situation decides whether it is pure or impure. If we have a doubt that if there is something which is ashuddha, so what do? We have to understand, like, you know, as I said, we have to sprinkle it with the water from the purified water, then it becomes shuddha. This is anna. What kind of anna is shuddha? This is something we may not like. What kind of anna is shuddha? That which is within a period of a yama. What is a yama? Approximately 2-2.5 hours. No, even if it is refrigerated, 2 to 2.5 hours is yama. Food within that cooked period is shuddha. If that food is re-cooked, re-boiled, it is ashuddha. Why the Ayurveda says, why should it not be re-cooked? It says, as many times you process, that much weak the food becomes. It even claims, dvipakam vishavatyajet. That is why I said most of you may not like it. That is also ashuddha. That is, eating food raw is also ashuddha. It has to be either baked, cooked, steamed, or roasted. One of the processes has to be done. Because the food material per se, it grows in the bhumi. There is a lot of things that come with it. Just by water purification, it may not remove all that ashuddhi. So one of these processings is necessary. That's why salad is also not that, what was that? No, the spinach had something to it, tomatoes had something to it. E. coli or salmonella, there's various bacteria effects. Wo raw khate rahoge to kya ho jayega? Lene ke dene pad jayenge. So one kind of this shuddhi has to be done. Why is it have to go through one of the processes of steaming, baking, cooking or roasting? One of them has to be done. It has to remove that impurity in it. Okay. That is with regards to anna. With regards to neer, the water, how should the water be? It should be coming from a flowing source. Not a stagnant source. And there is a certain parameters that even if it is a lake, the lake has to be a certain big, and this, when there is certain dimensions, if it is that big alone, that water is good for consumption. Otherwise, the smaller ponds are used for various other purposes, not for drinking. So, if the water is not flowing, say if that technicality, if you take it, turn the tap water on, water is flowing, right? It is pavitra. How many bottles do we drink in a day? Eight bottles? Good. If you drink it from a bottle which can be reused, we are saving that much plastic, let alone about water. Ecological system. So water has to be flowing, and that water has to be strained. That water has to be strained with a cloth if it is in a non-rainy season. If it is in a rainy season, then it has to be boiled, allowed it to settle, and then strained and consumed. That is when it is pavitra. Cloth, the cloth that we usually wear, cotton and various things, has to be washed in every 8 hours. Meaning, if I wear in the morning, I have to discard them by evening and wear them only if they are washed. What kind of clothes are okay for more than 8 hours? I said silk. You wear silk and once in 15 days dry it in the sun, the cloth becomes purified, shuddha, purer than silk is the wool. Wool, once in a month you can show it to the sun, and then, and you don't need to dry it like the silken cloth, but you have to just jhadna bolte hain Hindi mein, English mein kya bolte hain, jadofai, thoroughly shake it in the sun's presence, it becomes purified. That is why those who are working in the temples, they wear the woolen things, easy to purify. Those who come to the temples on special occasions are requested to wear at least silk, so that pata nahi kahan kahan kab kab ka pehen ke aaye. Silk is pure. I am just trying to read the entire list here. Dhanya darva asti tunam rasayite sacharmanam kalavayavyagni mrittau parthivanam yutayutaihi. So, these following materials, grains. How do you purify them? You purify them by drying under the sun and allowing it to get aerated. I mean, like air and sun purify. Similarly is the logs of wood. Many things which are now impossible to use, like the bones of the elephant, what you call the tusks. So they also are purified by exposure to the air and sun. That is not mentioned here. Madhu is honey, the original one. I just had to mention
then salt and such material, you know, they also are purified by exposure to the sun. Ghee, on the other hand, this subtlety that I just read today, there are two words for ghee used in Sanskrit, ajyam and ghritam. Both mean ghee, but until today I didn't know what the difference was. Ajyam is the butter which is turned into ghee on a fire, whereas it becomes ghritam when it turns into ghee by exposing it to the sun. Imagine the butter getting to that boiling point to turn into ghee, how hot it must be. They must sure have used some method or some technique to turn it into ghritam. And such ghritam exposed to either fire or to sun remains purified for years together. And what is the purification? That probably is the only material which does not stink or stale. I think in one of the, I forget which temple it is, either it is Palani or that you get even 100-year-old ghees, which is supposed to have certain medicinal qualities, very costly though. The materials which are made of mud get purified by baking them in ovens. There are certain materials that you use, you know, the mud, you use water and you scrub them to purify them. You know, the material like silver or you know, copper and such material, they use the bhasma, ashes, carbon ashes, and they use tamarind, and they use little bit of salt or sand, and then they scrub it so that it gets its original glow. Then it's considered as purified. I will tell you a fact. Thank goodness Bhagavan gave that insurance right in the beginning. Whether you understand these details or not, whatever you do, whatever you are interacting, in the beginning and in the end, mat smritya, constantly remember the Lord and performing it, it makes it pavitra anyway. There are certain things which go according to the ashrama dharma, and you cannot be overdoing them. I mean, you cannot be going beyond those rules and doing it. Like what? One of the classic examples that I take is the Putra Kameshti Yaga, you know, the one which Dasharathji performed. Who is qualified to perform this Putra Kameshti? Just because you have desire for children, you cannot go sit and perform. You have to be in grihastha ashrama. Both the husband and wife should be present. That is when you are qualified for performing Putra Kameshti. If a grihas, if the brahmachari or a sannyasi or a vanaprasthi it wants to perform Putra Kameshti, he is disqualified. So when a brahmachari or a vanaprasthi or a sannyasi performs Putra Kameshti, it is called Nishiddha. When at the same time when somebody who is qualified performing, when they perform it, it is called their guna. Guna and dosha is decided according to the varna, according to the ashrama, according to the swadharma. There is one very beautiful sentence that Bhagavan says. Patitanam ka patakam.
those who are fallen, those who are already on the floor, they cannot fall further. But those who have grown subtler even a bit, they have to walk cautiously. Because as you keep stepping subtler and subtler, higher is the probability for you to descend that far down. Most of the presentations that I have seen on Rishi Vishwamitra, Brahma Rishi Vishwamitra, they are pretty demeaning sometimes. That, you know, these rishis have no other thing but they have lot of kama vasana, they fall prey to that. They have lot of krodha vasana, they pray to that. They fall prey to that. One beautiful aspect is as subtler he grows, the tests that he fails, he falls. He does not leave it there. Within that very lifetime, he continued to grow out of it, those conditionings, to become a Brahma Rishi. That bottom line has to be understood. And it is not to portray him as the greatest Mahatma. He is like you, me or anybody. There is a lot of Kama Vasana, there is a lot of Krodha Vasana, there is a lot of Ahankara. And he works systematically, meticulously, and he falls. And he raises up again. So when we grow subtler and subtler, the probability to fall down is higher. And in certain people who have grown subtler, there are one or two things which might be irritating the people around. Swamiji, they say that there is a Mahatma, but you know, they have this weaknesses. Even there is, you are wearing a mechanic suit. Sit anywhere, it doesn't bother. In fact, if you come sit inside this hall, we have to be careful. If somebody wearing, you know, clean clothes, even if there is one stain on it, doesn't it become obvious to everybody to note? Similarly, as purer we become, our own inadequacies will become irritants for ourselves. And they become the cause for us to fall. So, why do we have to follow this dharma and this nishtha? So that it gives that railing as we grow subtler to take that support so that we don't slip. When they say do this, don't do this, they are meant for the upliftment of that jiva and to protect the jiva that the jiva doesn't slip. If that perspective is not understood, yes, it appears very constraining. And when we fall, that fall is called nija atmaghata, self-inflicting. Because atma cannot be killed, so there is no atmahatya, atmaghata. It can, you can feel the hurt, nija atmaghata. So to protect oneself from that atmaghata, this rules, regulations, do's and don'ts have been prescribed. As meticulously as you follow, when you even not understand it, when you grow subtler, you will see, oh, this was what it was meant for. But as I said, until that buddhi kida stops questioning and starts having faith, until that transformation happens, however we may listen, we still look it from that speculative mind. Okay, that is, but there is always a but factor there. There are certain things factor that Bhagavan is saying. He is taking one of the examples that people often use to justify. So Bhagavan says, this comes in the 21st chapter, 27th, 28th and 29th shloka. So he says, those who have lost proper vision, how do they behave? They take to the life of himsa and kill all these poor animals so that they can relish the meat, mamsa bhakshana. So in certain parts of yajna where it has been prescribed that you may offer mamsa, why is it that Bhagavan very clearly says here, why is it that he said that you can offer mamsa there? It is not because mamsa is required. It is because you already have fallen so low that you cannot think anything other than mamsa to be offered. So at least offer it there, so that with your constant offering and intensity, you can grow out of it, was the purpose. Now that clause is taken as a rule and people justify, oh, it has been said in the Vedas that you can now offer and bali chadao or khao, or offer in the yajna and eat as a prasad. That is still considered as tamasic. Even that tamasic, I mean, this is just one example, such tamasic patterns, offer it to the Lord and have it so that one day the Lord becomes important and not the offering, and you grow subtler. That is the idea, that is the purpose. But we take that exception to make it a rule and apply it in a very generic pattern, liberally. So much so that I had a, let me just conclude with this. I was invited for a fundraiser. You know, there was a temple fundraiser. So I had gone there, and just the day before, I had asked them what is the minute to minute detail. So they said, first there will be some invocation, there will be lighting the lamp, then there will be my speech, and after that there will be some cultural show, and during the cultural show there will be a bar open, and as appetizers you have a choice of vegetarian and non-vegetarian which will be supplied. I said, if these things are continuing here, I don't want to be a part of this this entire proceeding. I'll return back immediately, and you don't bother to pay my airfare too. And you should see that entire community react. Oh, this Swami knows nothing. We have had even in the Vedas prescribed that you can offer certain mamsa to the Lord and you can still have them. I am a Bengali, in our tradition we know that we do it. Why it is an exception? It is an exception which cannot be turned into a rule. It is given so that we grow out of those kinds of tendencies and conditionings and do not take them as rules. So Bhagavan says that please take the name of the Lord and we will be able to grow out of these shuddhis and ashuddhis. We will be able to turn the ashuddha into shuddha by just taking punito bhava, by taking the name of the Lord. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
हरिः ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ